Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Here I am, Skip E Lowe, here at the memorial service for Tyrone Power, who died November the 22nd, 1958. And this is the car that they drove him in. 1958, here in Hollywood. We're here at the services. There were 3,000 pushing fans here for the memorial services in 1958. Tyrone Power, the great actor, love, Latin lover, was married to Linda Christian at the time, and Linda Christian was here, and as a matter of fact, today we're going to see Linda. Linda Christian had bare children with Tyrone Power, Lynn Romana. She was only 8, Taryn was only 6, and here we are back in Hollywood, we're going to be doing the memorial service of Tyrone Power, one of Hollywood's great beauties, lovers, Tyrone Power. And here we are. So let's go into the memorial service, okay? Thanks. Here we are, ladies and gentlemen, November the 22nd, 1958. One of Hollywood's greats, Tyrone Power, passed away. And here we are at the memorial service. Here is 1995, November the 22nd. And guess what, ladies and gentlemen, right now, they're going to have a memorial service, one of the great stars here in Hollywood, Tyrone Power. This is the car that they carried his body, a beautiful black Rolls Royce. And the original. Today, I understand his two daughters will be here, his son, Tyrone Power Jr., and his wife, Linda Christian, one of Hollywood's beauties, who's been living in Rome, and Mexico, and she's here today to come to celebrate. This is the first time she had been here, and her daughters and her sons all together. First time since then, they were little children. Everyone here in Hollywood is waiting. The one of the great greats, Tyrone Power, a great 20th Century Fox star who's been with 20th Century for many, many years. Matter of fact, made David O. Selznick's a big star then. So here we are right now. We're going to be talking to Linda Christian and the children. And he's got fans. Look around you. Fans still are still coming to the graveside of Tyrone Power. So let's go and see. I am with Dan Patterson, who's been coming to these memorial services for about 10 or 11 or 12 years. Is that
that's
right,
correct. Dan? Yes, Skippy, that's what I've been coming quite a while. And Bud has asked me usually to speak on the films of Tyrone Power.
You're a big fan of Tyrone Power, were you, as a child?
Yes, I was. He and Errol Flynn were my two favorite actors.
Right.
And every chance I get, I still see Alexander's Ragtime Band or The Black Swan
right.
or the Eddie Duchin story. And I especially liked him in Nightmare Alley, which was a film he fought to do after he got out of the Marine Corps. Uh-huh. He was in the Marine Corps as a captain, and he was a pilot in the Marine Corps.
Uh-huh. And he was a good flyer. Matter of fact, I understand Cesar Romero and him flew together.
It's very possible. I know he and MacDonald Carey used to fly together.
Right. Uh-huh.
Yes.
Films. How many films did Tyrone Power do for 20th, let's say?
Well, I don't know. He was with them a great number of years.
Uh-huh.
I'm just guessing a 30 or so.
Your favorite was what movie of Tyrone?
Alexander's Ragtime Band.
Well, I'm going to say my favorite. Go ahead.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Yeah, go ahead.
In Old Chicago was also a favorite of mine.
I'm going to say my favorite was The Razor's Edge with Van Baxter and
John Payne and Clifton Webb.
That's right.
I think Ann Baxter got an Academy Award for her performance in that, yes. And it was his first film after getting out of the Marine Corps. It was released in 1946, and it was a huge success.
So you did your homework on Tyrone Power, didn't you? You know a lot about him, don't you?
I think so. I like to think so. But there's people that know more than me, and after these memorial services,
uh-huh.
they'll come up to me and say, oh, they should have had me speak because I know this and I know that, and oh, boy. So there's people that know. Tyrone had star quality, and he was very well liked, and he still has fans today.
Star quality. Looking back, We don't have star qualities today like big movie stars like Tyrone Power or Cesar Romero or Jim's. Today's we have Dan Carroll. You know, who do we have?
Bruce Willis.
Is he a star? I don't think so.
Right.
Films, the book you're holding, this is Tyrone Power.
Right.
These are the films. Is look at that face. That is what you call a movie star.
He was good looking. He was a good actor. He was popular with the people he worked with. And
they loved him in Spain. They loved him in those South American countries, didn't they?
Yes, they
did. Why did they? Why would you say they loved Tyrone Power so much in South America, Mexico, and under which he died in Madrid, ironically?
Yes, it is. Well, he was in Blood and Sand. Mm-hmm. He was in The Mark of Zorro, two very popular pictures. Mm-hmm. Perhaps that had something to do with it.
Anyway, we're going to be here. Linda Christian's coming, I understand, with her children.
Oh, yes.
Is and Tyrone Power Jr. coming?
No, he has never attended the services, but his daughter, Tyrone's daughter, Taryn, will
she's
expect
coming in from Wisconsin.
Yes, I believe so. And I understand that Coleen Gray and Terry Moore are coming today.
Terry Moore, great.
Two of his leading ladies, mm-hmm. and both of them very happy to have worked with him.
Nice talking to you.
Same here,
Patterson.
Skippy.
Nice seeing you again.
Same here, okay. Skip.
Take
I appreciate
care. Thank you. Now we're going to carry on a little, okay? Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, here is Tyrone Power's tombstone. This is where Tyrone Power is buried. He was born 1914, and he died at 1958. Today is the memorial services here at the service. He still has fans from 1958. Could you imagine? And this is so many years. Now we're waiting for Linda Christian and the services. Tyrone Power was in the Marines, and guess what? Even in 1950, from 1958 and here today of 1995, the Marines are still sending him flowers. They never forgot this great man, this great human being who loved the service, loved this country, and he fought for this country. A proud Marine, a proud father, a proud actor, Tyrone Power. Here I am, once again, at the Hollywood Memorial Service for Tyrone Power. Look at this number. This is the original license plates of this beautiful car, this Rolls Royce, that they carried his body to the cemetery. This is a beautiful, and it's still new. Look how beautiful it is. The place, the people here. Look at this beautiful cemetery. Take a look over there. Look how quiet. This is the Hollywood, old Hollywood. This is the beautiful, beautiful memorial of Hollywood. Memorial, sir. Great cemetery. Matter of fact, we have Jean Wallace is buried here, Tyrone Power's ex-wife. Also, we have so many, like Cecil B. DeMille. I understand Cecil B. DeMille is right over there. But here we are, Tyrone Power. With Linda Christian. Linda, how are you? How do you feel? This is since 1958 here at the memorial. You've been coming here every year, haven't you?
37 years. That's a long time, huh?
Yes, and you had two children with him, or three? Three with Tyrone Power?
I lost three and had two.
Two?
Yes.
And the two living children are?
The living ones are Romina and Taryn.
Uh-huh.
And Taryn should be here shortly. Uh-huh. Romina is very busy in Europe singing. So,
what has Linda Christian been doing with herself? Living in Europe, in Rome, Mexico, Palm Springs? What have you been doing?
The last year it's been Palm Springs.
Uh-huh.
Before that it was Italy and Spain,
uh-huh.
and England. A lot of back and forth.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. How do you feel coming here? You remember this moment. Let's go back all these years. How do you feel about this?
I'm amazed how many people still remember Tyrone and how they come every year. It's lovely. Hi there, sweetheart.
Every year?
Yes.
What do you think this is? Same as Jimmy Dean. But Tyrone Power was truly a movie star.
Yes, he was adored by everybody. In Europe, when we would be traveling, they'd say, Tyrone Power.
Uh-huh.
And I was amazed how they recognized him,
uh-huh.
with a beret and an open car.
Linda, how long you were married to Tyrone Power? How many years?
Well, we met in 47, we married in 49, uh-huh. and he asked for his freedom in 55, so.
But the I understand the weddings, and yes. was in Rome, was it?
Yes.
And you got married, I understand.
Yes.
What a wedding.
What a wedding. I could hardly move. In fact, I was late because of the throngs.
Right.
They were up on the monuments and on the telegraph poles. Everywhere you look, there's just throngs of people.
I'm looking at you right now. Mm. We're here at the cemetery. What went through your mind at that moment when you heard that Tyrone Power, he was making a film in Spain?
Mm-hmm.
Went through your mind that he had a heart attack and died?
What went through my mind is that I warned him that he had something wrong with his heart, and he said he didn't want to know. He just...
So you gave him the warning to go see a doctor?
He had had his cardiogram done, and they said to him that he should wait because they had to double check, and then they said there was something wrong with the machine.
Yes.
And I told them that there was something wrong with his machine, that he shouldn't take that for granted.
Mm-hmm. I'm looking at you right now. You look beautiful.
Thank you.
And nice seeing you, Linda.
Same here,
Skippy. I don't
want to
keep you. They're waiting for you.
No, that's all right.
It's a beautiful day, okay?
Yeah.
Thank you, darling.
Bye-bye.
Marvin Page.
Yes, Skip.
One of the great Hollywood's casting directors.
Oh, well, we try.
I mean,
we
friends
try.
Of all the stars. You've known them all.
Well, we try to keep the legend of Hollywood alive and going, as well as young Hollywood and early Hollywood.
Right. When you first came to Hollywood, you were very young here.
I came out here around 1959.
So that right after Tyrone died.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah, I'd met him in New York. I was producing a series called Luncheon at Sardi's.
Right.
And I think he was doing The Dark is Light Enough on stage with, I think, Catherine Cornell.
Uh-huh.
And I'd met him briefly then. And he seemed like very, very happy to be doing stage work.
That was a true movie star. We don't have true movie stars, legends like Tyrone Power.
Well, you don't have a studio system to build people these days.
True.
That's so there's really only one form of studio system today, and that's the soaps, strangely enough.
Right. And matter of fact, Marvin Page, he was casting director for General Hospital for many, many years.
He did that for 9.5 years.
Nine and a half. Fact, made a lot of stars.
All kinds
of stars.
Things.
Young well, stars.
Kind of helped the career.
He certainly did.
And John Stamos and Emma Sams and Demi Moore and Janine Turner.
Wow.
Brought Rick Springfield back into the business.
How's Margaret O'Brien nowadays?
She's fine.
You still see her?
Oh, sure.
You always go into these galas with all these great Hollywood stars, and they all love Marvin Page.
Well, you know, some of the wonderful people that made this business happen.
Anyway, this memorial service is very touching right now of Hollywood.
Yeah.
His fame is still... Look at the crowd. Still
I know.
Coming.
I know.
1958, and this
mm-hmm.
is 95.
It's still going strong. Just shows the kind of magic and image that Mr. Power had.
That's it. Hollywood has a lot of magic. And Marvin
Let's
Page,
hope it'll continue.
You're a magic...
And thank you for helping to keep the magic going, too, Skip.
Thank you, Mark.
Right.
Thanks, Mark. Here we are with one of the great Hollywood stars and legends. Believe me, when I used legends, Terry Moore.
Hi. It's always so good to be with you.
That Burt Lancaster movie of yours, I just keep watching it over and over.
Oh, you Come Back, Little Sheba.
Come Back, Little Sheba. What a great film.
Thank you. I enjoyed making that so much. And of course, I got nominated for an Academy Award, so that was very thrilling.
Uh-huh. Tell me, you did a film with Tyrone Power, did you?
I did King of the Khyber Rifles with Tyrone Power.
Did you really?
Yes, and I think it was the first year I came to the memorial, and I couldn't even get up and speak. I love this man so much. He was such a kind, great, great man that I was so embarrassed because I couldn't get anything out. I just sobbed.
Uh-huh.
And now it's taken me 37 years to really contain my emotions. I've only lately been able to watch his movies because I think that anyone who ever knew him loved this man.
And a true movie star. That's what you call a true movie star.
Oh, probably the most beautiful, handsome movie star we've ever had. I mean, he is to me the ultimate when it comes to movie star.
Mm-hmm.
And he had a nobility that died with him.
20th Century Fox Studios, looking back
What a studio.
Oh, I know.
They made great stars out of there.
Oh, they did. Uh-huh. Marilyn Monroe and Shirley Temple, of course, uh-huh. and Betty Grable and Alice Faye. Uh-huh. And
you came with the system, though,
yes,
Terry Moore. You were very young.
I spent 21 years of my life under contract to three uh-huh. studios.
And married to Howard Hughes, one of the greats. And also, who really discovered Terry Moore, actually?
Let me see who actually discovered me. Wow. It's hard to say because I go back. I've worked under four different names, and I started when I was 11 years old. Uh-huh. So I would the first job I ever got was at 20th Century Fox through casting director Owen McLean. I don't uh-huh. know if you remember him, a wonderful man, but I was Helen Coford then I went to the name Judy Ford, then uh-huh. Jan Ford, uh-huh. then Harry Cohen christened me Terry Moore.
That's it.
Of Columbia Studios.
He christened Terry Moore.
Yes,
uh-huh.
yes. And it came about very funny because uh-huh. I was in this movie called Return of October opposite Glenn Ford.
Right.
And he said, we can't have two Fords in one movie. And I was so like the girl in the movie, and there had never been anyone in Hollywood or a girl called Terry before. So he asked every studio head to send in a name they thought was right.
Right.
When I got to his office, he said, what would you like to be called, Helen? And I, have you thought about it? And I said, Terry. And he said, well, evidently you're in agreement with every studio head. They've all, every studio department head,
right.
they've all put in the name Terry. Uh-huh. And he said, we can't use the name Ford because of mm-hmm. Glenn Ford.
Right.
So he said, I turned to my mother and he said, what's your maiden name? And she said, Bickmore. And he said, too long, but I've got a letter right here from Coleen Moore on
right.
my desk. That's it. Terry Moore. Nice to meet you, Ms. Moore. Goodbye.
Is she here today, Coleen Moore?
I'm sorry, not, Coleen Moore.
Yeah, is she here today?
I have no idea.
Yeah, I thought she was supposed to come.
Oh, I would love to meet her because she doesn't realize that
uh-huh.
I'm named after her. Yes.
Terry Moore, I don't want to keep you. The memorial service is starting in a few minutes. And,
yes.
Run through your mind, Tyrone Power. Just say one last word when I use the word Tyrone Power. What would you say?
Courageous.
Thank you, Terry.
Thank you.
Goodbye. Thanks. Here I am with Coleen Gray, one of Hollywood's great legends. How are you, darling?
I'm just fine.
Made a great movie, The Alley of
Nightmare.
The Alley of Nightmare,
that
right.
That was a great film. That was at 20th Century, was it?
Yes.
Yes, you were with 20th Century for a long time, weren't you?
About 7 years.
7 years?
Mm-hmm.
And working with Tyrone Power, here we are today celebrating his...
His death.
Death. 1958. God, that's a long time.
Well, it was only yesterday.
It seems like it.
Yes.
Working with Tyrone Power, if I use the word Tyrone Power, what does come to your mind?
A princely gentleman.
That's a nice, that is encouraging, princely. That, I'm getting these great words about mm-hmm. Tyrone Power. What did you learn when you was working with him in films? What did you learn from Tyrone?
That a person could be successful and still be courtly and polite and a gentleman.
We don't have movie stars today.
No, and we don't have very many courtly gentlemen.
No, we don't. And in America, especially, we
yes.
don't have that. Coleen, I want to know, looking back over Hollywood, I'm looking here at this Hollywood Cemetery. This was a beautiful cemetery. It was well kept.
Mm.
Looking around today, it's not really well kept. And we're right in the middle of Hollywood. What do you think of Hollywood today?
I don't think... it does not occupy my thoughts.
Your thoughts?
No. I think about other things.
Well, thank you for talking to me.
You're very welcome. Thank you.
Enjoy that movie, too.
Thank you.
Thank you. Here I am with Richard Harrison, one of Hollywood's great stars who lived in Europe so many years.
25 years.
Richard
yes.
Harrison, here at the memorial service of Tyrone Power. Did you ever meet him when you were a kid?
No, I didn't. I before I knew Linda,
uh-huh.
I was I don't know if you can say a fan, but an admirer of both of them, not just uh-huh. not just Tyrone Power, but of Linda, because they represent the elegance to me, and he represented the great talent. You know, here's a man who had elegance, talent, beautiful man, uh-huh. the way he dressed, the way he behaved. I was wondering to myself, just driving here, if a man like that could be a star today. I mean, he had every quality you need to be a star. But could he be? Would he be a star? Would he be in Die Hard and things like that? Mm-hmm. I mean, what do you think?
Those those are not movie stars to me. Those days are gone because we had a Hollywood system. We had the movie system telling you what to do. They groom stars like yourself. You were groomed. You were in Europe. You were groomed there.
Yes, but wouldn't you like to have the elegance back again? I mean, wouldn't it make you feel good?
Richard Harrison has nothing but elegance.
Oh, thank you.
Tell me, you've been running for the mayor of Palm Springs. What happened? My God.
Things were going very well. I came in third out of nine. I felt very good about it. I only ran because there were many things in Palm Springs I wanted to see changed, and I didn't realize when you go against the machine, you're really going against the machine.
Uh-huh. So you do have a little regret about that?
Well, I regret, you know, people actually cried. I mean, the people in the stores, they actually cried when I lost, and I was taken by that. It's something that I'm not sure I'll do again. I may, because people are asking me to, but what I want to do right now is start a film commission there.
Good.
All right.
That's what we need in Palm Springs, you know. Anyway, I think we're going to start with the memorial service. So,
okay.
Richard Harrison, I'll let you go.
Thank you very much, Skip.
The 37th Annual Memorial Services for Tyrone Power. And for the opening prayer, the Reverend Dan Smith of the Toluca Lake United Methodist Church will give the opening prayer.
Join with me as we share together in prayer. Let us pray. Creative, expressive God, you have given to certain people the special gift of sharing and creating images for which many will come to see and enjoy. This community has been instrumental in dispersing those images to the joy of many throughout the world. We come together today to celebrate and remember one of our community's own, Tyrone Power, whose presence in this business and on the silver screen brought forth the acclaim and adoration of many around the world. Bless, we ask, this gathering as we remember and celebrate the life of this giant in our midst. We invoke your special spirit to be here with us today. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Smitha. And we have with us today actress Maggie Sebastian, whose father, Ray Sebastian, was Tyrone's personal makeup man. And she will tell about her memories now.
Good afternoon. As I look around, I see a lot of familiar faces and a lot of new faces that I haven't seen. My father was very blessed because he was very talented, and he worked with some of the most incredible actors and actresses in this industry in its golden age. And he always said that the best part about his job was having to work on some of the most beautiful faces. And one of the most beautiful faces that he got to work on was Tyrone Powers. And not only was it a beautiful face, but he had a beautiful soul. And in that soul, my father and he became the very best of friends. And to my family, he was always known as Uncle Ty. And so I want to say thank you to all of you coming today to share in what my father started with Batesta 37 years ago to remember a very dear friend and a very talented actor. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Maggie. We have with us our film historian, Dan Patterson, who will give a review of Tyrone Power's films.
Good afternoon. It's so nice to see all of you here again this year. And Mrs. Howard, Taryn. And it's always a pleasure to come here and speak. And I suppose I have to start off with an apology. Last year I said that The Razor's Edge was not a big hit. Marvin Page reminded me that he thought it was, and he was right. The Razor's Edge was the first picture that Tyrone made after his military service. It was released in 1946, and it was a huge grosser. And it was nominated for four Academy Awards, including Best Picture, Best Supporting Actress for Anne Baxter, who won. Best Supporting Actor for Clifton Webb, who didn't. And for Best Art Direction. The picture was a huge grosser, and where I got my mistaken opinion was the critics hated it. They said Tyrone looked bad in it. He went around very dreamy, that it had no pep or energy. The critics did not like the film, but the public was anxious to see Tyrone again, and they made it a huge grosser for 1946. In 1947, of course, Tyrone made a wonderful film, which he fought to do. He went to Daryl at Zanuck and asked Daryl to buy the book of Nightmare Alley, and Daryl didn't want to do it, but Tyrone convinced him to do it, and he did make it. The picture didn't do so well at the box office, but it was a critical success. All of the critics said Tyrone is finally mature. He finally shows he can act. The picture was very well received by the critics, but not so much at the box office. But I think it's a fine film. And today we're very fortunate to have Tyrone's leading lady in the film, Miss Coleen Gray. Usually I talk about what a wonderful looking man he was. We know that. We know he's a good actor. We know that. He was good in Nightmare Alley and Witness for the Prosecution and so many other films. And I think what we forget, or I overlook sometimes, is he was well liked by the people he worked with. I have never heard anyone say an unkind word about him. Everybody that worked with Tyrone liked him and respected him and admired him. And of course, we here today all know that Tyrone had star quality. So if Tyrone were here today, I think he would say just one thing. Thank you for remembering me.
Thank you, Dan Patterson. As you all know, Tyrone served his country well as a pilot in the Pacific Theater of War in World War II. Now we have with us to give a tribute from the Marine Corps Staff Sergeant Dan Doherty.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Staff Sergeant Tim Doherty. I'm from the Marine Corps Public Affairs Office in Los Angeles. And it is indeed a great honor today to be here to speak with you a little bit about Mr. Power's role in the Marine Corps. Of course, I'm not very familiar with him, as the fact is I'm only 29 years old, and a lot of this stuff to me is very new. And I just moved to Los Angeles about 3 months ago from San Francisco, where I was a recruiter. But there are certain things that I know as a Marine that I've learned throughout the last 11 years in the Marine Corps that I think are really important. And maybe if I mention a few of those to you, you can understand a little bit about why his time in the Marine Corps was so important to him. I was reading something earlier today concerning him, and there was an interesting line in a book called Anyone Here a Marine? And the very last sentence in it concerning Tyrone Power said, later in life, after many years in the national limelight, Power asserted to many that his Marine Corps service was the most unforgettable experience of his life. A lot of people look upon their time in the Marine Corps, and although it had only been a few years, maybe for some only a few months, that time of their life is looked at as being probably the most important time. A lot of what I've done in life has been due to the Marine Corps. I wouldn't be here today if it hadn't been for the Marine Corps. The Marine Corps sent me to about 40 different nations in the entire world. I've been all over the place. I lived in Japan for a few years, all over the United States. I'm originally from Milwaukee, and a lot of it is due to the fact that I decided to take up the challenge and become a Marine. And you look at that time in your life very fondly. You can remember a lot of things that, a lot of good friends that you made and a lot of good things that you learned because of the values that the Marine Corps instills in you. So I have just one final comment to make, and that concerns heaven and the Marine Corps. A lot of people, especially some of the more famous Army generals, were told that there are no Marines in heaven. And one of the more famous generals, General Patton, arrived on the streets of heaven, and he's looking around, and he didn't see any Marines, and he went up to St. Peter, and he said, "I understand that there are no Marines in heaven." And he said, "That is correct, General." He said, "Okay, that's fine." He took a couple more days of his time up in heaven, and the next thing you know, he sees a guy dressed like this in his dress blues. He had to go hunt down St. Peter and ask him, "You know, you told me before there are no Marines in heaven." "Well, I just saw a guy dressed in dress blues a few minutes ago." St. Peter said, "You did? Again? Well, that's the Lord. He just thinks he's a Marine." So, with that, I'll say thank you very much. It's indeed been a pleasure to be here with you all today. Thank you.
Thank you, Sergeant Doherty. I'm sure Ty would appreciate your tribute. And now with us again is Taryn Power, Ty's daughter, who will tell us of her family remembrances. Taryn?
Hello. Well, this was a surprise to me. I thought I was coming to witness a memorial service. I've been out of the state for a year and a half, and I was glad to be back in time for this, but then I saw my name. My heart's pounding real fast. I thought, oh no, I wasn't prepared for this. Remembrances. Oddly enough, one of my earliest and one of my only memories of my father is right here at the gravesite. We attended a service after his burial, and I just remember standing there with my sister. I remember it very vividly, the whole picture, and I remember being 5 years old, and there was this elderly lady standing near my sister and I, and she was just sobbing uncontrollably. And at that age, my sister and I looked at each other, nudged each other, and we just started laughing. You know, I mean, that was how we handled that situation. But I guess my regret is that I didn't really know him personally. I've heard so much over the years, and anywhere I go, when people find out that he's my father, their face lights up, and they're just they seem to always have some kind of fond memory, whether it was in light of being a fan or having known him personally. And that makes me feel really good. Like I say, it's been more living after he passed away with his memory and with memories of other people of him. And I feel like it's hard for me to forget, you know, because something like this amazes me, that after 37 years people still come to remember him and pay tribute to him. And I was thinking real fast as I was sitting there, well, what else, you know, and I thought, well, I have to share one thing, which is, I mean, personally, I just feel like he's in my heart and in my thoughts and in my prayers, but like I say, I don't really have any vivid recollection of being with him, but I knew what an avid pilot he was. And I personally have a fear of flying, and every time I get in a plane, I always have to imagine that he's flying the plane, and that really just makes me feel so much better. I just figure, you fly it, okay, you know. So I just want to thank you all for being here, and as was just said, you know, for remembering him and honoring him, and thank you all.
Thank you, Taryn, for those beautiful words. And we're happy to have with us again Linda Christian, film star and former wife of Tower.
Hello, everyone. I wasn't prepared either. Taryn, this was such a touching speech. Yeah, really. I'm sorry you couldn't have known your father. You shouldn't have made me feel like this. Well, anybody want to ask me something? Huh? Lately, this last year, I've been in Palm Springs, which has a lot of memories, too, and lots of photographs with Ty when we used to go there and stay with the Xanax. His boss. Yes? Sorry? Oh, well, that was in Rome, in magical Rome, when my sister wanted his autograph and was very insisting, and we were in the same hotel, and she got on the phone and said that she wanted his autograph, and I took the phone away and apologized for calling at that hour, and he sort of said, well, why don't you come over and have a drink? And I said, I don't drink. And then, what about the cigarette? Well, I don't smoke. Well, what about the autograph for your sister? And my sister go, yeah. So we went over, and when the door opened, all the bells in Rome started to ring. It was a telephone. And it was Lana sort of saying, where have you been all night? And he said, well, I went out to dinner with some friends. Well, are you alone? I said, why? Well, tell me you love me. And he turned around and said, I love you, to me. And that was it. Well, it's a lovely gathering here today. Thank you all for coming, and let's hope that we can keep this up for many a year.
Thank you, Linda. That was very touching. And now another star who starred with Power in King of the Khyber Rifles, Terry Moore.
Whenever I'm interviewed or I meet people and they ask questions, one of the first questions they always ask me was, who was the nicest star I ever worked with? Well, I never have to think twice. It was Tyrone Power. He was the kindest, most loved person I think I have ever known. He was just as loved by the studio guards and right on up in every department as he was by the studio heads. He treated everyone the same. I remember my mother saying to him, Ty, you're as beautiful on the inside as you are on the outside. And one day, when we were in Lone Pine shooting King of the Khyber Rifles, he looked at me and he just had such a glow, and he said, I have had the most wonderful life. He said, if I died tomorrow, I'd have no regrets. And he said, wait, there's only two things I would like to have before I die. I'd like to have a son, and I'd like to die on stage the way my great-grandfather and my father did. And I'll never forget that one day I was in New York, and I couldn't quit talking about Tyrone all day long. And I went back to my room at the Plaza Hotel, and the telephone rang. It was Robert Evans. And he said, have you heard? And I said, Tyrone? And he said, yes, he died today. Well, I said, thank God he's going to have his son. And he died on the set of making that last picture, Solomon and Sheba. So he had all his life's wishes. I thought it was very interesting that Nikki Blair, who I'm sure most of you know from Nikki Blair's restaurants, Nikki Blair told me that when he was in the service, he was told that he was going to be a rear gunner to one of the greatest pilots in the Corps. And they said, not because he's Tyrone Power, he's one of the best fighting men we have. Well, to me, he had more courage and more nobility than any star that was ever on the screen. And why shouldn't he? He was a Marine, a United States Marine.
For those wonderful words, Terry. And now bringing us a word of appreciation from the motion picture industry is film star Coleen Gray, who co-starred with Tyrone in Nightmare Alley. Coleen.
Thank you. Well, I don't know what I can say on behalf of the film industry. I have only my personal recollections of Tyrone Power. And they started, I think it was around 1935, something like that. I was a Minnesota farm girl, and I loved movies, and Loretta Young was my favorite female star. And we had no money. The only way I could get to see a movie was to earn the money, and I used to style hair for the ladies on the farms for 10 cents a head. And it took 2.5 heads to make 25 cents. And with 25 cents plus a nickel for ice cream or popcorn, I would walk 2.5 miles to go to a matinee in Hutchinson, Minnesota on a Saturday afternoon. And on this particular Saturday, the movie was called Love is News with Loretta Young and Tyrone Power. And I fell in love that day. And he became my favorite motion picture actor. And little did I know, as time went on, that our paths would cross. I was lucky, fortunate enough to be signed at 20th Century Fox. And sometime after that, I read the book Nightmare Alley by William Lindsay Gresham. I knew I was meant to play Molly. And I went to see Mr. Zadnik. And he was terribly nice. I said to him, you're from Wahoo, Nebraska. I was born in Staplehurst, Nebraska. So that gave us a commonality. And he said, if they could get a large male star of gigantic proportion to play the geek, then they might go with an unknown for Molly. And so I won't bore you with the circumstances, but that became my privilege. And it was one of the most happy times of my life as far as motion pictures go. It was what I call the Camelot period. And every day was a joy to go to the set and work with that phenomenal cast and that excellent director, Edmund Goulding, who also directed The Razor's Edge. Ty Power was still my idol. It was just incredible to me, a happily married woman with a child, that I should still look at this handsome god, as he appeared to be, and have a heart flutter. It did, truly. That doesn't mean that one is unfaithful, but one does have these feelings. They do indeed. And I remember, I loved to look at him. And there were times when Lana Turner would visit the set. It was when they were going together in 1947, I believe it was. And I would be in my trailer, and I would look out through the blinds and just stare at this beauty, male and female sitting together. They were so handsome, so sophisticated, so they were the embodiment of everything physically beautiful. And that was something that I will never forget. The thing that I remember most about Ty was that he was a gentleman, very courtly, very polite. I was much too terrified, and still remembering the Minnesota farm girl business, that I did not engage in lots of conversations with him. I was there, and I did my lines and all that sort of thing, and he was very, very kind to this frightened young starlet. I remember mostly the way he walked, and one time especially, he was dressed in the tuxedo for the nightclub act that we did, and he walked as if he had a string suspended from his head and from his chest. His posture was magnificent, and he walked as if he were 2 inches off the ground, that his feet never touched the ground. And he had an aura about him, I swear, it was a kind of a glory. And that's the way I remember him. He was my Prince Charming, and to this very day, with the exception of my dear husband who's sitting here, who is my Prince Charming. But in those days, and as I remember Ty, he was a gentleman, and anyone's complete definition of Prince Charming. Something happened not long ago. Somebody sent me a prayer. It's the Lorica Breastplate Morning Prayer of St. Patrick. And I wondered, why did I get this? What will I do with it? Here I am, a good Presbyterian, and St. Patrick is Catholic. And it's a beautiful prayer, but what will I do with it? And then I was invited to be here today. And because Ty was Irish and such a marvelous person, I would like to read to you this morning prayer of St. Patrick, who lived in 400 A.D. and wrote beautifully. This prayer was written in Irish and Latin, but happily for you, I will read it in English. I arise today through the strength of heaven, light of the sun, radiance of the moon, splendor of fire, speed of lightning, softness of the wind, depth of the sea, stability of the earth, firmness of the rock. I arise today through God's strength to pilot me, God's might to uphold me, God's wisdom to guide me, God's eye to look before me, God's ear to hear me, God's word to speak for me, God's hand to guard me, God's way to lie before me, God's shield to protect me, God's hosts to save me from the snares of the devil, from everyone who desires me ill, afar or near, alone or in a multitude. Christ with me, Christ before me, Christ behind me, Christ in me, Christ beneath me, Christ above me, Christ on my right, Christ on my left, Christ when I lay down, Christ when I sit down, Christ when I rise, Christ in the heart of everyone who thinks of me, Christ in the mouth of everyone who speaks of me, Christ in the eye that sees me, Christ in the ear that hears me. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Coleen. Not only were you a fine actress, but you sounded like you were a great movie fan. And now we'll have a closing word of prayer from Reverend Smith.
Before we share our final prayer, I'd just like to make a mention. This past week has been we celebrated the 220th birthday of the United States Marine Corps. Isn't that right, Sergeant? You betcha. And I think it's appropriate, being the legacy that Mr. Power has shared here in this community with those who have served with him, before him, and since. And I'm a retired United States Navy chaplain who served with the Marine Corps, so I think I have a little bit to say about that. That indeed we are indeed blessed to have such fine individuals such as Tyrone Power being in service to our nation, our community, our God. Would you join with me now as we share together in a word of prayer? Lord, we must do more than imagine what you are saying to us. We must listen to you, speaking to us in our lives and in the world, through every event, through every life, and in the significant life we celebrate and remember here today. Active we must be, yes, but still also, from time to time, quiet enough to hear your voice. Go with us now, from this time, from this place, with that special sense of your spirit with us. In your holy name, amen.
That concludes the 37th annual memorial services for Tyrone Power. Thank you all for coming, and hope to see you all again next year. Well, any of you that want...
One of one's great daughters. How are you, darling? Taryn?
I'm well, thank you. I'm pregnant.
You are? She's going to tell the world. Are you really?
Yeah.
I love it. Really? How many?
This is the fourth.
Is it the fourth?
Yeah.
You have two daughters or two sons?
Two daughters and a son.
You've been living in Wisconsin. Right?
Yes.
Tell me about that.
Well, it's very quiet and very beautiful. Uh-huh. I felt like I almost did like a year and a half of solitary.
I'm sitting out there listening to you today, the way you said, I remember this when I was a little girl, at five years old, and you were giggling. Isn't that interesting? Because every little girl is giggling at five. Is that correct?
You know, it's those things where when you have to put on a straight face and you burst in. I mean, we were literally like out of control giggling. Uh-huh. We couldn't, and we were giggling because it just sounded funny the way this older lady was crying. But I've thought about it since, Sunny, because I find I have a problem dealing with death. Uh-huh. I don't know if it's because I was exposed to it at such an early age with such an impact that. To me, it's like just part of life.
I want to know, Taryn Power, coming out here. You've been coming out here how many years now?
Pretty much consistently for over about 22 years.
22? Because you only got a house here in Hollywood.
Yeah, right, we used to live here.
To be near your dad.
Well, I used to feel very unrooted. And when I found out that my grandfather had passed away in Hollywood and then my father had lived here and was buried here, I felt like this was as much of a roots place as any place for myself. So it was very comforting to be living in Hollywood.
And you did acting?
Yes.
Still, you don't do it anymore?
No, I mean, I wouldn't mind, but uh-huh. but I don't know, I have a lot of opinions from feedback, uh-huh. so I feel like, well, never mind, you know.
But, growing up here in Hollywood, mm. in Rome, Paris, all over the world with your mother, Linda.
Mm.
She lives in Rome now, or she lives
Palm Springs.
Palm Springs.
Mm-hmm.
So nice. You just came for just this particular interview?
No, I'm back here for my older daughter's last year in high school, so we're here till next
she
summer.
She stays with her father.
Yeah.
And that father is?
Norman Seif.
Norman Seif, who is your, his father is?
No, that was Tony Sayles.
Tony Sayles.
That's the father of the other two.
How many times have you been married?
This is my third.
Oh, it's your third.
Yeah.
You're catching up with your mother, aren't you?
Well, I figure I follow my father's footsteps.
Your father's footsteps. Nice second.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dylan.
Thanks.
Lots of luck.
Thank you.
Here I am with Maggie Sebastian, one of Hollywood's child stars. Matter of fact, you grew up here, didn't you, dear?
Yes, I did.
Growing
all my life.
All your life. Growing up here. And also, here we are at the Tyrone Powers Memorial Service, but you just gave an interesting, touching speech up there about your dad. And about Tyrone, how friends they were.
They were best of friends.
Your dad was a makeup artist at 20th Century Fox.
Right.
And best of friends of Tyrone Power.
Right. In fact, he died in my father's arms in Spain, shooting Solomon and Sheba.
Did he? Really? In
mm-hmm.
Madrid?
Mm-hmm.
In your dad's arms?
Yes. In fact, my mother and I were supposed to leave the next day
right.
for Spain because my father and Uncle Ty were going to start their own vineyards.
Uncle
and
Ty,
wine.
So that must have been very close, you guys. Huh?
Very close. He was a member of our family.
Uh-huh.
Many a dinner party at my parents' home.
Can you share some moment right now with us? Just one moment, maybe?
Oh, sure. One, my mother reminds me of this one all the time, and I wish this one had come true. I had gotten some Roomba pants. I was about 3 years old, and I walked up to Uncle Ty, and I flipped my skirt up, and I said, "Look!" And I showed him all my ruffles.
Uh-huh.
And he turned to my mother, and he said, "I wish she'd do that when she's 16. So he had a great sense of humor.
That was a very touching speech you just
did. Thank you very much.
Listen, you're a comedian now. You're an actress, comedian.
Yes, got my Emmy for the late Mr. Pete show.
That's right. You're on Mr. Pete's show. That's right. You got an Emmy for that, too.
Right.
What's happening with that show now?
Kind of gone into that...
Other things?
that burial.
You're doing comedy?
Yes, doing stand-up around town,
uh-huh.
here and there.
See, I wish you'd come to see me. I'm at the Comedy Store, and I'd love to see you.
I'd love to come see you and work out with you.
We would love that.
Okay? It'd be terrific.
Thank
you for taking the time.
Thank you. You're very sweet.
Thank you.
Here I am with Grace Robbins, who is friends of...
Linda?
Linda.
Yes, Linda, Christian, and I. Whenever she comes up to L.A., she stays here. And for some reason, you know, I was here last year, and I thought that this year was even more... touching in a way, the things that the people said about Tyrone. I never met him, mm-hmm. unfortunately, but I always loved him.
I love Coleen when she
yes.
said about Princely and a gentlemanly,
exactly.
the way she said, and he
just
was.
Just as he looked, actually.
Yes.
I hope that maybe one day I'll get to meet him.
You know, Grace Robbins, you surround yourself with princely gentlemen all the time. If someone's rude, you do not.
Why don't we
show
them?
You want to share them?
Yes.
Look at those princely guys.
Yes.
You always surround yourself with gentlemen.
I do.
Why is that, Grace? May I ask why?
It's the only kind I can communicate with.
Okay. Thank you, Grace Robbins.
I love you,
darling. I understand you got a book coming out.
Huh? Oh, I do.
Yes, tell us about that book.
It's about...
your life, naturally, with Harold.
Yes, with Harold Robbins.
Is it called Harold and Me, I understand?
That's the working title.
Is it?
It might be the title.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Exciting.
It's coming out next year.
Are you going to really give us the dirt, Grace Robbins?
There's no dirt, really. It's just...
tell-all?
It's no tell-all. I'll tell you what it is.
Yes.
It's the life of two incredible people, and at an incredible time, in
right.
the 60s and the 70s.
Mm, that's
you
good.
You got it from there.
Okay, darling.
Okay.
Bye-bye, dear.
Bye-bye.